of Thomas Vinterberg's The Commune. This is the North American premiere. We are very pleased to present this film at the Visa Screening Room in the beautiful and historic Elgin Theater. We'd like to thank Visa Canada for making this possible. I want to remind you guys, this film is eligible for the Girls' People's Choice Award. You can vote on the film's page in the official Tiff app, or you can just put your tickets in the ballot box outside the cinema as you leave the film. We'd like to thank Trust Nordisk for providing us with the film, and a big, big thanks to the Danish Film Institute for their ongoing and extremely generous support of our program. It's a real pleasure to be up here to introduce this film. It's made by one of the finest directors in the world. You may have seen Celebration. We have a pretty good show on here. Dear Wendy, I think in this very theater, The Hunt. This film is about the impact of social change on a family in my favorite decade, the 70s. It's driven by a truly set of amazing performances. Including Albert Thompson, who you guys can know from a variety of films, and a great performance by the lead actress. She won the Best Actress Award in Berlin, Trine Dyrholm, who you know from In a Better World, All You Need Is Love, and A Royal Affair from a couple years ago. Just an amazing performance. Now, if you could, join me in welcoming the one and only, the great Thomas Vinterberg.
Amongst intellectuals, beers, pipe smoking women, and genitals. And I guess you can understand why I miss it so much. On several occasions I've been asked to, even urged to, make a movie about that. And I've chosen to show both the love and the sacrifice. So hey, it'll go dark eventually. I am Scandinavian. But I hope you'll enjoy it. We'll discuss it after, don't we, Q&A?
We will be back.
So if a couple of guys and girls stays around, we can talk. I want to thank Toronto Film Festival, particularly you, Steve. Trine Dyrholm. In a minute, you'll see why. But this film is why. She's probably the most generous actress out of the world. So please enjoy and see you later.
Stick around. We'll be back.
Thank you.
on communal living? Anyone? Just wave. I'll repeat. Someone? Okay, I will start. Okay. Who were you in the film, Thomas?
Well, I was many of them. I guess, you know, I was the age of fire, and I started to live in a commune. But I was the age of Eric when I got divorced. So, you know, I'm a little of every one of them, I guess. But my perspective of this film, I guess, primarily is from Fryer.
Thank you.
Thanks. Right there.
Why did you decide that the wife rather than the girlfriend?
The question was, why did the why was it that the wife left instead of the girlfriend?
Well, did I decide that? I think this film is trying to be honestly and brutally confrontational about the fact that nothing remains. People fall out of love, time passes, things change, and marriages break up. And I guess that's why.
Next. Yeah, the waiting there.
I was working with Trine like now as opposed to what, how many years ago?
Many years ago.
How is it? It's a bit more expensive.
Question
was. And I guess the same goes the other way around. Trine, how is it working with Tom now as opposed to when he was starting out?
I think it was much more interesting now, I have to say. The all the discussions about the characters and the story and all the work, it was at another level because we have all gained experiences, all in not only weight but also we have learned a lot, and it was really inspiring teamwork.
I worked with Trina when she was like, what, 19 or something? First time? 20? Whatever. And I remember she changed something in her choreography, and then she waved at the camera assistant and made a line so that he could be sure to be in focus. And I was like, fucking hell. She's a fucking pro. And this is now 50-something films ago, and now she's just an incredible. She's just the most fine-tuned instrument you can find. And it's the same thing with her. And also, I thought it was interesting to make a film with these, you know, Ulrich and Trine, and a film we did many years ago called The Celebration. It's 80-something years ago. But they agreed to marry. And now here they appear as married. You know, we kind of like that.
I'm curious about, normally you see young filmmakers that make kind of, they make the film that they are, or the film that they know, the film they grew up with, to start out. Why this film now, as your career has grown, why this personal film now? What, has it been gestating for a long time, or is this something that has just come to you? If you can speak a little bit more to the process of the reaching for now.
Gentleman asked about, you know, said that a young filmmaker is often making films about themselves, and he wanted to know how this film came about at this point in Thomas's career. Was it gestating for a while? It has an interesting origin. It was a play.
Well, first of all, as a Dane, being in a commune isn't that interesting. It's like we have a lot of those, and we've had a lot of those through the times. So to start with, I never really considered it. Now, going a bit more international, everybody talking about it all the time. And then there's this theater director saying to me, please do a play about your commune at our national stage. Why don't you test your dramatic material here and see if it works? And then I did, with 9 German actors. I don't speak German, but some translators and some gestures and this and that. And actually, it was being a show where people stood up and applauded and played for 2 years, and it was a successful experience. And then I decided to put it on screen. That was the journey of it. I was a little afraid of doing something autobiographical, which is, it's not actually. It's kind of more personal than it's private. And I like that.
There's somebody over there.
Can you repeat that?
How come within a divorce situation? Then? Oh, are communes and divorce common in death?
Combination of being a twin and a bisexual and then living in a commune and being on the island. Living in communes was very normal at the time that I grew up in the 70s. My street had 32 houses. And 10 of them were communes, which is a very specific answer. The divorce thing, I don't know. I guess it's very pretty normal to be divorced all over the Western world. And then I was not.
So basically, yes and no. is there anybody in the back? Oh, yeah, right there. What was your favorite character's name in the film?
My favorite character would be?
Who was his favorite character?
Okay, yeah. Who were your favorite characters in the film?
I was in it as well. I was an extra.
It's the waiver in the front row of the balcony there, yeah.
There's a strong theme of children and child innocence throughout the movie. At one point, the backdrop of the Vietnam War, the news team is talking about millions of children dead, somewhat sarcastically. I was wondering if you could speak to that element of the film, what it represents to you, or what you try to convey with that.
Gentlemen asked about the comment on the theme of childhood and childhood or innocence was in the film. If you could talk a bit about that.
Well, there's many answers to that. One of which is that we decided to be specifically non-political. I mean, the time that I grew up in and the environment that I grew up in, there was a lot of political debate all the time. But it was a lot of people showing off. It was, people consist of what they show to the world. And we were more interested in what they were hiding and what's behind the surfaces of all the ideologies and stuff. So we decided to not write about politics. Vietnam War is mentioned in this scene to show how isolated this is, how self-absorbed they are. People are dying all over the world, and here they are suffering in this little microcosmos. But yet still, also we had a theme of the loss of innocence, I guess. It was very beautifully naive what my parents did back then. And they utterly believed in this way of raising children. They believed in this way of living. And I thought that was kind of beautiful. And I guess this scene mirrored that somehow. I hope so.
I always thought that the Lars character, Lars Ronti's character, was sort of he was kind of like the fake leftist.
A lot of fake leftists. But there was also real leftists. There was this, like this guy who would suggest that we pay rent per income. Okay? And he was the one making the most money. So his income or his rent would go up 4 times. That guy doesn't exist. I thought that was very interesting and fascinating, even as a child.
We can do one more. There was someone down in the front. Oh yeah, over there. Yeah, the waiver over there.
This particular young boy died, obviously, of a broken heart, and because of a time falling out of love. Everything and everybody fell out of love, and it was replaced with something else in which he couldn't exist. Again, I guess that's the loss of the innocence. That's why he died.
Okay, maybe we'll do one more for
non-hierarchical, they vote on everything, but then could you say more about the husband when they decided that the female lover should move in and then he...
The question was, if you could talk a bit about this, sort of kind of, a bit about the sort of, well, they claim it's not hierarchical, but of course it is. The husband makes the, you know, the Ulrich's character makes the decisions in the end, if you want to comment.
You know, they all seem to have a voice, and then there's the end, where I just decided. Actually, in real life, we didn't vote. It was kind of not classy to vote. That was a capitulation. It had to be discussed all the way through to agreement. But in that case, the film would have been about 34 hours. And I've had endless meetings and consensus situations, so I'm actually kind of allergic to that. I can't have any consensus about anything. Because I've spent years of my life discussing if we should have a dishwasher. So when Eric breaks through and just makes a decision saying it's my house, it's a great relief for me.
Yeah, on that note.